So you might be asking yourself, how are blood-borne pathogens and infectious diseases spread? Well, first let's look at what a blood-borne pathogen is. It's a microorganism, such as a virus, that are present in human blood and can cause disease in humans. These pathogens include, but aren't limited to, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and human immunodeficiency virus, otherwise known as HIV. Infectious disease is a disease that enters into the body through various routes that is caused by microorganisms such as bacteria, fungus, or a virus. And infectious diseases can range from mild to even life-threatening. For disease to be spread, it requires several conditions to be present that we call the chain of infection. There must be an adequate number of pathogens or disease-causing organisms. There should be a reservoir or a source that allows the pathogen to survive and multiply, in other words, blood itself. A mode of transmission from the source to the host, an entrance then through which the pathogen may enter the host, and lastly, the host has to be susceptible. In other words, they don't have an immunity to that virus or bacteria. Infection control strategies serve to prevent disease transmission by interrupting one or more links in that chain of infection. The primary source of potential blood-borne pathogens is blood and specific body fluids, like semen and vaginal secretions. Other bodily fluids may contain blood-borne pathogens, especially those visibly contaminated with blood, such as cerebrospinal fluid, which is usually found around the brain, synovial fluid, most often found around joints, pleural fluid, which lines the lungs, amniotic fluid that is in the uterus, pericardial fluid, which is around the heart, and peritoneal fluid, which is around the abdomen. Urine, feces, saliva, and some other body fluids do not typically carry blood-borne pathogens, but when introduced with blood, also become potentially infectious materials. However, it can be difficult to identify a body fluid or know for sure whether or not it is contaminated with blood. And in general, you should treat all body fluids as potentially contaminated with blood with the potential for carrying a blood-borne pathogen's disease. So if we could be sure that we could always keep the blood-borne pathogen outside of our body, we really would never have to worry about this. But unfortunately, there's many routes that do introduce that disease into us. And the four basic modes are what we're going to discuss now. The first one is direct contact. This occurs when microorganisms are transferred from one infected person directly into another person. Examples of this would include a caregiver who has an open, uncovered wound and blood from a patient contacts the caregiver's wound. Parenteral exposure is this that comes in infected blood and then is introduced directly into your body through like a piercing wound, like maybe a needle stick or some type of sharp, jagged glass that has blood on it or metal and then jabs into your body. Indirect contact involves the transfer of an infectious agent through a contaminated object or person. An example would be a caregiver that doesn't wash his hands in between caring for someone with infected body fluids and other patients, or a person picks up a blood-covered material with his bare hands while cleaning. And then airborne transmission, which occurs when droplets or small particles that contain an infectious agent then and are remain effective over time and distance in the air, like tuberculosis, for instance. That's a very common disease that's spread this way. Blood-borne pathogens are not typically spread in this manner. You might be wondering what the most common way that blood-borne pathogens are spread. And it's most commonly spread through sexual contact. That's the primary mode of transmission for blood-borne pathogens. The highest potential risk while providing medical or first aid care exists when a contaminated sharp object cuts or punctures the skin. A parenteral exposure is what that's called. Now, examples would include like a needle stick, injection from drug usage, a cut from broken glass or metal, or human bites. A medium potential risk exists when an infected body fluid gets into an open cut or a mucous membrane, such as in the eyes, mouths, ears, or nose. The lowest potential risk is when a contaminated object touches inflamed skin, like acne or skin abrasions. In addition to knowing how blood-borne pathogens are spread, it's just as important to know how blood-borne pathogens are not spread. Intact skin is our first line of defense against disease, and blood-borne pathogens cannot soak through normal intact skin. The Centers for Disease Control, or the CDC, states that there is no known risk from exposure to intact skin. Unlike some infectious diseases, blood-borne pathogens are not spread by casual contact, such as handshaking, hugging, doorknobs, or using the same equipment, like toilets or water fountains.